Welcome, friends. Can you hear me at the back? Yes. Okay. I am very happy to see you here. You are joining me for this three-day event to learn about meditation. That is why we call it meditation workshop. It's a little new way of saying. If somebody had told me when I was young, we are going to a workshop, I would think we have to deal with machines and nothing to do with meditation. But the terminology has been accepted to make it look like workshop is a workplace. Meditation workshop is a workplace for meditation. So we do not come just to discuss the different types of meditation, what they mean. We come to see if the practice of one of those meditations gives the result that is claimed by those who prescribe or suggest those meditations. To meditate is to think about something. We are all meditators. We are meditating constantly about worldly things, our responsibilities, what we have to do tomorrow. All the time our brain is meditating on something or the other. When we say a spiritual meditation or a meditation to discover our own self, it means to meditate on the spiritual self, on our own self. What is our own self? We are all considering our bodies to be our own self. We have been given names for our bodies. Somebody calls us by that name, we respond. That is our self. This is so much of an assumption that our self is our body. We do not know any other part of ourselves. We can say that we have a mind that thinks. We have a brain that functions, causing thoughts to come. They function within the body. We can say we breathe, we have life within the body. We are considering the starting point of meditation to be ourself, the physical body. And yet, while we are assuming the physical body is ourself, we hear ourself is immortal. Ourself is a soul. Nobody has seen a soul. I've challenged anybody to come and tell me he saw a soul. Nobody has seen a soul, and we talk our real self is a soul. All words, no experience at all. When we say we are a soul, we are assuming soul living somewhere in the body. We are still taking the body to be ourselves. It is very difficult to get out of this assumption we make and continue to assume all our life that the body is ourselves. No matter who the teacher, who the yogi is who's teaching us yoga, he starts with the body, tells us what to do with the body. Sit in a certain position in the body. Follow the 84 asanas prescribed by yogis from centuries on the body. That's yoga. That's union with your true self. To make different contortions of the body, of this physical body, yoga, highest form of realizing yourself. What is the self? This body, again. We meditate. We are told there is a place inside our head, third eye center. There are many centers. There are centers all over the body. Centers of energy, centers of awareness. Nobody's seen them. All words, all talk about it. We're still in the body. Where are the centers? In the body. Who are yourself? The body. I am bringing up this point right in the beginning of this meditation session, that it is not easy to get over the assumption that our self at this time is our body. We cannot get over it. No matter how much we talk about something else, the body remains our self. And the implication of assuming that the body is our self is very wide. What is the assumption? We are real body, this is our self. And all the other bodies we are watching are also real selves. Therefore, there are billions and trillions of cells, not only in the form of human bodies, other forms of life. Trees, insects, birds, mammals, dogs, cats, horses, all have bodies. They are all real. Would they be real if we did not think our body is real? Think over this. If we did not think that our physical body is real, none of those things would be real. So, assuming that we are, our body has made a material world, a physical world, real for us. We have an experience, all of us have an experience, when we are not in the body. That is when we go to sleep at night. When we go to sleep, we don't know where we go. In the morning we wake up, we are in the same bed where we went to sleep. We, during the night, we don't know where we go. Sometimes we have dreams. In the dreams, we see ourselves in a different body, not this one. And yet we know that you are the same self in the dream, not somebody else. Throughout the dream, we are constantly conscious of the fact that the dream body is our real self. Nobody can have any other assumption in a dream except the dream body moving around, seeing things in a dream is ourself. Which one is ourself? The dream body? Or this body we are wearing now in the physical wakeful state? In the dream, we are sure that is ourself. Because we move around. We look at things, not somebody else. We are, in a dream, we never see somebody else walking around. Sometimes I give the example of Fa Heen, the Chinese philosopher, who had a dream. In the dream, he felt he was a butterfly. His body changed. He was a butterfly and he flapped his wings and went from flower to flower. The flowers were so beautiful, he had never seen them in physical life. They were emitting colors and lights out of them. He had never seen flowers like that in his whole life. And he was surprised that as a butterfly, he could see so much better than he could see as a physical human body. He woke up and found he was Fahin, human body, and began to think, how is it possible that I am a human being and in the dream I was a butterfly? In the dream I had an experience much higher, much more beautiful than physical experience. Maybe I am a butterfly. And that was my wakeful state. And now I am dreaming, I am thinking I am a human being. Am I a butterfly really? Or am I a human being? So he told his friends of this strange dream. And he said, I had a very strange dream in which I was a butterfly, flowing around, and these are the kind of gardens and flowers I saw. The friend said, don't be stupid, Fahim. You are a human being. That was just a dream. It was not real. You cannot be a butterfly. How could you assume you are a butterfly? Don't keep on saying, I was a butterfly. Say, I saw a butterfly in a dream. He said, I never saw a butterfly. I was flying. I did not even see my own self. I could not see my own eyes because with these eyes of the butterfly, I was seeing the world. Am I not a butterfly then? This question led to the discovery that the form that we take has no relevance to the self. The self can take any form, you still feel it's the same self. And yet we are taking the form that we have now as ourself. A simple experience like a dream tells us that in the dream we have a different body, a different self. And we call ourselves as that being with a different form. People have had some, girls have come to me, said when they dream they are a man. Men have told me in their dream they become women. Are they men or women? Which one is true? Forms can change. People say we have reached a state of samadhi. in which we dissolved ourselves into nothingness. And I asked them, when you were nothingness, how did you know you were nothingness? You must have been there. If there was nothingness, you couldn't remember anything. You were never nothingness. Your form was nothingness. You were still the same self. That is why you can tell me today about nothingness. We do not realize that this basic assumption, that this form we have taken for a physical experience in a physical life, lasting a small period of time in terms of cosmic time, is just a form and not ourselves. Yet we assume it's ourselves. So the starting point of discovering the self is a faulty one. It's a faulty one to say, I am going to take this position now, I am going to close my eyes, I am going to see what is there. If you are doing that, you are dealing with a body, just a form. But the one who is saying, I am going to do this, the one who is assuming, I am the body, is the self. Claiming, I am the body, is the self, but not the body. So that is why most of us, doing several kinds of meditation. I think I must have tried so many kinds of meditation myself when I was young. And each one of them claiming, you can go to the energy centers, you can go there, you can go higher awareness, you can do all that. All related to the physical body. We sit in a physical body, think, close our eyes. And closing eyes has shut ourselves from the world. Never. I've never seen anybody closing eyes and forgetting what is outside. You can close your eyes, you still know where you are sitting. You still know where your feet are. You still know where your legs are. You still know where your hands are. You're totally aware of your body. Not only that, you're totally aware of the world that you remember outside. You've gone nowhere. Closing eyes and contemplating on anything is merely meditating upon the same thing. I am the body and this is my world. They're not got out anywhere. So that is why when I have invited you to come and join me in this meditation workshop, I want to bring the fallacies, the faults that we start with in meditation. That we begin to assume that a meditation is a practice we can do with our bodies. Meditation cannot be done with the physical body. Anybody who has tried to do meditation or yoga of any kind with the physical body is stuck to the physical body and stuck to the physical world. No matter how hard you try, it doesn't help. So you will notice that most of us have spent our life trying to do this. Sitting in the body, closing our eyes of the body. And therefore, assuming that we are in a state of meditation because we are not looking outside. If you close your eyes, what happens? They're same eyes. You're just not letting the eyes see outside. Eyes are still trying to see outside. Closing eyes does not take you anywhere. No matter how long you sit. You can sit for 12 hours with your eyes closed. And if you open, you still see the same world. You're not gone anywhere. Well, they say, well, we have some magical words called mantra. We repeat those magical words. That's meditation. Not closing eyes. Repetition of words is the secret. The mantra is the secret. Simran is the secret. Some secret words can take us right up to our true home inside. And we repeat those words. Phonetic symbols made up of sounds, of physical sounds, spoken by our tongue. Listened by the physical ears. Can those words take you anywhere except put you into the physical world? How is it possible? To use physical means to go somewhere else doesn't work. And what happens? We are constantly imagining that repetition of physical words, repetition of mantras is taking us somewhere. Taking us nowhere except another state of being in the physical world, in the physical body. You can keep repeating forever. I heard an old story of an American disciple who heard that there was a Swami, a yogi in India living in the mountains in a cave, and he had some very special mantra, special words. If you repeat those words, you get enlightened. And since I found out that most Americans like shortcuts, they want everything instantly. So therefore, he said, this is instant knowledge, instant enlightenment. It's worthwhile going all the trip. So he took the trip to India, had a hard time reaching those mountains, but he did reach the cave of that holy man. Holy man was inside the cave. A few of his disciples were sitting outside, and he waited. The holy man came out, and disciples said, I have come all the way from the United States. I understand that there are some secret words you tell us, and if we can repeat them, we get enlightened. Is that true? He said, yes, that is true. Can you give me those words? Certainly, you come all the way, I'll give you the word. Come close to me. And the seeker kept close to him, and he whispered, the secret words are abracadabra. He said, what, I've come all the distance to hear abracadabra? The Swami said, no, there's a catch to it. When you say abracadabra, do not think of bananas, a fruit. Say abracadabra, no bananas. When you can say abracadabra without bananas, you'll get enlightened. He tried all his life. Every time abracadabra, bananas were in front of him. Do you see the simple trick he played on it? We're talking of words. What are words? What is language? Nothing more than association of ideas with physical experiences. That's all. We hear from childhood different words being spoken. We grow up understanding them, different sounds. We associate them with experiences. We hear the word chair, and the little baby chair. We say, put him on the baby chair. And the baby says, that's the chair. But that's the only chair for the baby. You grow up, no other chairs are also called chair. The meaning of the word chair expands. And therefore, it becomes all the chairs of the world. But the chair remains a physical chair. No matter how many times you say chair, you can say it 1,000 times, the chair will still be the same chair, whether it's a baby chair, or a big chair, or a sofa chair. These physical words that we are using, languages, are all designed to communicate with each other by referring to the same experiences we have had. And by the way, we believe that we can communicate well with language. I am not so certain. And I'll tell you why. Supposing I have always seen a small chair, somebody's always seen a big chair, and he talks to me about a chair, he's talking about a big chair. I am thinking he's talking about a small chair. No two people's experience is the same. Therefore, when we speak, we are relating those words to our experience. The listener is relating those words to his or her experience, and they are both different. We can never adequately communicate anything with any language. It's a very big shortfall in language. And we think, yes, we are talking very nicely, language everybody understands. Everybody understands according to the context in which they can place from their use of the same words, same symbols, same sound, same phonetic symbols. Birds are doing it, dogs are doing it, cats are doing it, we are also doing it. But just because we can make more sounds, more articulate things, therefore we think we are using language and they are just using sounds. No difference. They communicate the same way. So that is why language itself has a big shortcoming and cannot express everything that we want to say. And then we think just the words derived from the same languages are going to give us enlightenment. No way. No mantra exists which can take us anywhere. At the most, if I were to explain to you, you can speak a mantra with your tongue. You can speak a mantra with your imagination. You can speak your mantra with your mind. You cannot speak a mantra with your soul. If you are a soul, mantra is out of place. Remember this. And yet we are calling these practices as true meditation. That is not the meditation I have come to share with you. I have come to share with you a meditation, that's meditation on the self that never changes. No matter whether you have the body of an insect, body of a tree, body of a human being, body of an angel, body of God, or anybody, or no body at all, you're still the same self. What I have learned as true meditation from my master, Hazur Maharaj Baba Sawan Singh Ji, photo here, he taught me the meditation on the true self, which cannot be achieved at all by any mantra, any physical means, any sensory means, any mental means. That is the true meditation. It worked for me. It worked for him too. That's why he shared with me. It worked for me. That's why I've come to share with you. I am no guru or I am no yogi or something. You can see me. How am I dressed up? I'm not claiming to be anything except a disciple of this master, great master we called him, because he said, the purpose of true meditation is to meditate on the real self. The real self is what we are always having, no matter what form we take. We have the real self now, we have the real self in the dream, we have the real self in meditation, we have the real self in enlightenment, real self when we are in a true home. We never lose our real self. That self that does not depend upon any form whatsoever, that's the self that we are. And we test it out all the time in our dreams. We test it out in our ideas. The idea comes to a self. Thoughts come to the self. Visions come to self. Experience of the world come to the self. That self which is responsible for all experiences, no matter what the form is. That self. So his method of realizing that self, to know who we really are, that self, the ultimate self, that is what I've come to share with you. It's a large group. I would like to share this experience and how to meditate to achieve that state with each one of you. That is why, because the groups are large, we decided to have what we called IMR. When somebody told me, when is the next IMR, I thought he was talking of MRI, some medical procedure. Then I was told only, I introduced that IMR, Intensive Meditation Retreat. I limited the number of people to small number, 60, 70, 80 people with whom I can interact on a daily basis and practice methodically so that we can move away from the assumptions that we are carrying for our life, the assumptions we are a physical being, meditation is something to be done in the body, that assumption has to go away. So it takes a few days because the assumption is so strong in us. So we do the IMR, intensive meditation retreat, for at least 5 or 6 days. So progressively we can begin to move away from this assumption that meditation is a process done on a physical body, is done somewhere else, on the self, but somewhere else. So the very first thing in correct meditation is to get rid of the idea that meditation is an exercise in the human body. If you keep this assumption alive with you, you will stay in the physical world, in the physical awareness, and the physical body, no matter how hard you try. People are talking of meditation as concentrating your attention on an energy center. They say there are several energy centers. 6 energy centers are described in the body that are running our universe, running our consciousness, running our awareness of this universe. Where are those energy centers? In the body, located in the body. Starting from the rectum, the genitals, the navel, the heart, the throat, and behind the eyes. 6 energy centers And I practiced going through these energy centers using different mantras, different words at each center so that I can get the benefit of the energy of the center and move upward. And then spend a lot of time at Hriday Chakra, the heart chakra. So many people are assuming we live in the heart chakra. They think from here and say we are here. They talk from here, are awake from here, say we are here. I never understood that. How they assume that they live in the heart chakra when they're talking from the body. When they go to heart chakra, they're sound asleep. When you go to sleep, what happens? Have you ever noticed that when we go to sleep at night, are we meditating that we can leave our body? They say, well, by meditation, you can become unaware of your body. Well, then we must all be meditating every night. We all become unaware of our bodies. What does sleep do? When we are awake, if we were to say, our self, the speaking self, the thinking self, the self that is thinking at this time, where is it residing? A simple contemplation on your own feeling in the human body, if we are operating as a self, that means the I that's going to say, this is my body. Where does that I say, this is my body? It certainly doesn't say in the hands, you can be sure, nor in the feet or the legs. It still comes down to the torso. Does it say from the heart? Does it say from the stomach? Does it say from the throat? Or does it say from the head? Spend some time on this. You'll find when we are awake, it always says from the head, from the brain. It's so designed like that. When we close our eyes, where are we? We are not seeing the outside world, but where are we? Still in the head. Has anybody ever felt that my eyes are open, but I am seeing from my throat, or I am talking to my throat, my thoughts are coming from my throat, or from the heart, or anywhere other part of the body? They're all coming from the head, all the time. This first step to know that wherever that self is in the human body, it appears to be somewhere in the head. That's what we feel. But we feel that only when we are awake. We don't feel that when we are sleeping. We don't even know about our body. Where are we when we are sleeping? And in a dream body, we are moving around. Where are we in the dream body during sleep? Are we there in the heart of that body? Body is very similar to this body. Or are we in the head of that body? Always in the head. Whether you have this form or dream form, the I that wants to consider itself the self is always in the head. Well, that's a good assumption to make, that if there is a self that makes us conscious and aware of this physical world, is sitting in the head. We don't know what shape it has, but obviously we know the location. In the physical body. If the self is sitting in our head, our own self, and we are contemplating from there, thinking from there, then obviously these energy centers that are below us, below the head, and where meditational yogic practices of the energy centers are bringing our energies up from the bottom centers all the way up, they must be considering that the destination is in the head. We start from energy and go on to discover from where we are contemplating, meditating on those centers. That is why even if we have been practicing for a long time on the six centers of meditation, which we think are the six chakras of energy, which they are, I'm not denying that they are the centers of energy, but where are we getting awareness of those centers? Not from those centers, we're still getting awareness from our head. brain function like this, the physical body designed like that, that the thought process in which it develops our ego is operating in the head. Now, since the head is so important in the physical body, in the dream body, what about imaginative body? Let's think of something different. Supposing I imagine that I am not sitting here, I've stepped out and standing here. It's just imagination. I imagine I'm standing here, you imagine you are standing here. Where are you knowing you are standing here? In that imaginative body, still in the head of that imaginative self, nowhere else. You can experiment in any way, any form, make any form of yourself, and you will find that there is a head on top of that form and you are sitting in there. That helps us to understand that if we are looking for the self, we know where to look for it. If it is really in the physical body, at least we know where to look for it. And if we don't want to look at it physically, then look at it a different way. What's a different way? I just give you an example. Imagination. Is imagination physical? Not really. When we imagine something, there's nothing physical. Yet, it has something that we have here also. Supposing we imagine we are flying. We can't fly with this body, but we can fly with an imaginary body. Let's imagine we are flying, and when we are flying in our imagination, we are still in the head of that imaginary self. The form is very similar to this form, because that's what we are imagining. But that form, we can feel it, we are there in imagination. We can see with that form. If I were to say, I'm imagining, I'm seeing here, I can see all of you from the imagined self, so can you. What is the role of imagination? The role is, basically, it's not physical. It's a self, but not physical. That's a very good key to understand how we can shift our awareness for the purpose of good meditation, not stay in the physical body all the time, but to put it into a different perspective, a different form of ourselves, an imaginary form. We can all imagine we are imaginary. We can imagine we are birds, we are imaginary anything. We can imagine anything. Imagination is a very powerful thing. Where does it come from? Where does imagination come from? It comes from something in the head. The mind imagines, the perception of mental perception inside, different from physical perception, that imagines things. But if we can imagine ourselves, not the body, but an imaginary self like the body, and not imagine outside standing here, imagine where we are now feeling that we are knowing about the physical body from, the world from, which is inside the head of the physical body. Let's put the two together. We are right now in the physical body. Imagination starts from inside the physical body in the head. Can we imagine ourselves in the head? If we can do that, we are ready to meditate the method I'm going to explain to you. If that is the problem, we have to practice till we can reach that point. Don't start any meditation. If you want to have really knowledge of the self, make the self into a different form than your physical body. Make yourself into that which can be done easily while we are here in the physical body, imagination of a different form of yourself. Same in our eyes with the imagination. What will be the nature of an imaginary self? Supposing we want to say, I want to imagine myself without the body. What would be the nature of this body? The self will still be there,
The self is imagining the body. Thinking will still be there. It's not shifted. Now we are thinking, we are saying in thinking here, when we imagine ourselves, we are still thinking from there. Mind will be there. Self will be there. And on top of that, the ability to see will be there. When you imagine something, you can imagine seeing anything you like. The ability to see in imagination will be there. The ability to hear in imagination will be there. The ability to smell in meditation will be there. The ability to touch in imagination will be there. All five tactical and other senses of perception we are using in the physical body will be completely intact in the imagined body. It's a big, big thing. That the only thing missing in an imagined body, sitting inside the head, is the absence of the material self. Everything else is intact. If we can do this first exercise of imagining ourselves in the head, now one can say, head is very small. How can you imagine ourselves? Shall we make ourselves very minute, make it a miniature self and put ourselves in the head? Or shall we just close our eyes and forget the head? And wherever we are already in the head. Wherever we are, in the darkness that we see, by closing our eyes, in the same position of in front of the darkness, where the physical head is, we forget the head. In the darkness, we imagine we are in the center. Then we are as big and tall as we are here now. So long as we are thinking of the physical head, we cannot fit in the head. If you forget the physical head, just close eyes and say we are behind the darkness, that space is as wide as you want to make it. There is no limit, there are no walls there. In that darkness, you are standing there. And imagine you are seeing something you live to see. Can you imagine that the power of imagination will be able to see anything in the darkness in front of you? I have done these meditation workshops with people. See, can you see light? Yes. Can you brighten the light? Yes. Have you seen more light inside than never seen outside? Yes. What is the capacity of imagination? Where are we seeing these things? With our perception. Here we are assuming that we perceive what exists physically. There we imagine, and the perception of what we are imagining creates the object that we are seeing. And we cannot get rid of the idea here that we are seeing things because they are there. There we can say, yeah, I'm imagining it, therefore I'm creating the things that I'm seeing. It takes a little while to understand we are doing the same thing here also. We are using perception to create the material world, not the other way around. Inside you can see it more easily. Supposing you can do that, the imaginative self, not the body. And then say, with the imaginative body, now I am going to meditate. Do you know you're not meditating with this physical body at all? The very problem I mentioned, that we can't get rid of this idea of the physical body. We are constantly in the physical body. When we do any kind of yoga, any kind of meditation, is immediately removed, that obstacle is removed by meditating with your imaginative body. It has every feature complete. Complete sense perception, complete thinking power, complete life, like this one. And yet it's not physical. So the starting point of good, effective meditation is to get over this assumption of the reality of the physical body and the physical world is to start with your imaginative self inside. It's very important. If you meditate, start meditation with that, you are automatically starting at a vantage point. That means a non-physical state. What state is it? Well, we say imagination. One problem comes. It's imaginary, not real. Why are we saying that? Because this is real. We have still not got rid of the idea that the physical world is our only reality. Because when we are in the physical world and when we are in physical bodies, it is true that the experience is confined to a physical reality. No matter how much we talk about the other levels of consciousness and so on, the reality remains physical reality. And as it happens, when we go to the dream state at night, the dream state is the only reality. Physical disappears. If the physical is still there, then it's not a dream, then it's daydreaming. When you have a real dream, the physical reality disappears. Dream reality is the only reality. When we are awake, physical reality is the only reality. If you stay in the state of imagination and imagine you are meditating there, imagine you are doing everything there, you are eating your food there, you are exercising there, you are going for walks there, they are all possible in imagination. You are dancing there, you are meeting friends there. If you are doing everything in your imaginative self, there is no way that you can keep hold of the awareness of the physical self at the same time. If all your attention goes into the activities of your imaginative self, what happens? You gradually get into the same state, like in the dream. Dream, you had no control, it was automatic. Here you are under controlled conditions by self-imagination. You have put so much attention into that, you gradually become unaware of the physical world, the imaginative world becomes real, and at that stage you discover that's the only reality. That means we are so constructed. Our consciousness is so constructed, it lives in different realities. But at one time, only one reality. It cannot live in two realities at the same time. Either we are here, or we are in the dream, or we are in an assumed, practiced, imaginative world. We dismiss that state of imaginative world because we say it's imaginary. And we come back again to the physical world of reality. When we start from the physical world of reality, we assume this is real, therefore that is unreal because we have imagined it. We dismiss it simply by sticking to this reality. We can't do it when we are dreaming. What happens when we say it's an imaginary state? We are dismissing its reality and sticking to the reality of this physical experience, and we stay in the same physical body no matter how hard we try to imagine. If by practice you can give up this assumption that this is the only reality, think there are many realities. Dream reality, wakeful reality, imaginative reality. What will happen to the imaginative reality then? Imaginative reality will become reality, like this reality. It's a matter of practice only. Now, I am using the word imagination, imaginative. I can also use other words in the books. So, I quote you from the books, you have reached an astral state of being. The books say that. Never explaining what the astral state is. I am explaining the astral state. The astral state is nothing but to be able to hold your perception of the sense perceptions with the same mind, thinking power, with the same self, with the same life, and not be aware of the body. That's the astral state. And I'm just calling it imagination to make it easier to understand while you're sitting here in this reality. All imagination comes from the astral plane. Astral plane is the birthplace of imagination. Everything that we are producing here, the great ideas that come, are coming from the same imaginative state. The astral plane. Our body, which we thought we imagined was there, is the astral body. There's no other astral body. We read books and read these words and start assuming things, and therefore we dismiss imagination. That's unreal. I'm wanting for the real astral body. I want to find anybody who has found a real astral body that was not his imaginary body. power of imagination is coming from a different level of reality, different level of consciousness. When we are using that power here with physical form, it becomes imagination. We come up with strange concepts in the brain, in the physical world. We say, that's coming from my brain, my idea, inspirations are coming, this is coming from somewhere inside my physical head. Only by practice of meditation at different realities, you will find it's coming from a different reality. Realities are not anything except the state in which you can have experiences of different kinds. This reality we are sitting in now gives us physical experience, which means experience of the self, which is having the experience. The only experiencer that we have is the self. The experiencer is experiencing itself. We always know we have a self. Can you imagine? People ask for proof. You say there is something inside. Prove it. I said, do you exist? Yes, prove it. And nobody is going to prove that. They know it. What's the difference between knowing something and proving it? We all know we exist. Why? We all have a self. We all know we have a self. Therefore, we don't need any proof. But for anything beyond the self, we need proof. The self is always there. Who is experiencing this word? Self. Who experiences the dream? Self. Who imagines? Self. Who experiences the imaginative world? Self. The self is constantly there, and we never need any proof for it. Because the self is our own self. We never need proof for our own self. Our existence is self-evident proof of the self. Therefore, when we say that the imaginative self or the astral self is nothing more than the same self with the same life, same mind, same thinking power, same thoughts, same memories, but no physical matter. That's all. Don't make it too mysterious. To discover yourself within yourself should not be so mysterious as we are trying to make it. Therefore, if I would say, why start meditation in the physical self when the physical reality has overwhelmed us into a belief system that this is the only reality? Why not start from one level above, even if it looks unreal and imaginary, but the self is there doing it? That is why the starting point of effective meditation is not to meditate with this physical body, not to meditate with physical words, not to meditate with anything. If you want to use words, use the words which your imaginary self can speak inside your head. Not with this tongue, with your imaginary tongue. If you use any words, words can be spoken by the imaginary self. Words can be spoken by the mind. Words are never spoken by the soul. Why? How come if we can speak words with a form, why can't the self speak in itself by pure self, the soul? The reason is simple. If we study how this experience is being generated outside, if we just look at the world, what is the world? The world consists of simply two things, space and time. Everything else fits into it. Space, vastness. There's a vastness around us. And there is time flowing. Supposing we take one of these elements out, we say no space, world ends. We say no time, world ends. Have you ever imagined that the whole existence of a physical universe is based only on time and space? You take one of them out, everything disappears instantly. Therefore, this world is existing with events, forms, faces, experiences placed into space and time. We don't know where space and time are coming from. They're so huge. They are endless. When did time start? It might have started some trillion years ago. What was before that? More time. How far can you go? You can keep on going forever. Such huge time is there. How big is the space? Forever, infinite. You can go as far as you like, more space beyond that. Space and time, infinite space and time, are creating the reality of physical experience. They are also creating the reality of the imaginary experience. They are also creating the reality of our mental experience. Are they still creating the reality of anything more than that? No. Because when you see the origin of time and space, which can be seen through effective meditation, and I'll introduce you to that, to see how you can see the origin of time and space, infinite space being originated from zero time, zero space, and you'll see it happens in the highest mental state. The mind generates that experience. The mind without senses, the mind without physical body generates it, not in the body. When we use the same mind in the body, it's a physical mind. It functions within the domain of the physical universe. When we use it in the imaginative self, it's an imaginative mind. It's got a much wider sphere because imagination can go beyond physical experience. When you go to mental, it is even bigger. When you study what our mind really is, which you can through meditation, going within your own self, within your functioning of consciousness, you'd find the mind in the original form is responsible for the creation of the experience of time and space in all these three regions of the mind, the senses, and the body. If the mind is not there, do you know there will be no time and space? If there is no time and space, then what is left? Self is still there. If self is still there, there is no time and space. Then you can imagine that there is no way to describe it. No description is possible with the mind of anything that is not in time and space. That is why you cannot explain the true nature of the self. But you can achieve it, realize it, by withdrawing from the mind. So the method of withdrawal from one level of experience to another can take place, and that would be effective meditation, to be able to withdraw at will from one level of experience to another level of experience, from one reality to another reality. To withdraw at will is effective meditation. And we can reach the point where we can reach the point at the top of the mental sphere, the mental functioning, where time and space are created. It's a very interesting phase that we can reach by a method of withdrawing from one reality to another. But the assumption has to go that there is only one reality. If we confine our meditation to physical body, assumption does not go. I have tried it out. So many of you have tried it out. I hear from so many of you when you come and see me, you tell me your experiences. We tried this, we tried this, all based upon physical assumption of the reality. It doesn't take you anywhere else. Everything else, great experience. Where? In the body. Therefore, the starting point is to remove that assumption. Easiest way I found to remove the assumption is to start your meditation from a different reality, the imaginative reality, not from the physical reality. When we talk of words being spoken, they can be spoken in time and space. If there is no time and space, words have no place. That is why the self cannot be discovered from words. No matter how hard we try. Self has to be discovered in a different way. I'll take you through step by step during this short stay with me so that you can at least know the methodology, the method in which we can withdraw attention. In a simple way I could tell you this. If the self is operating from inside the physical body, let's go toward the self. Let's move toward the self. What is around the self? Around the self is our physical body, especially our head, our eyes in front. Let's go behind the eyes. Let's start our meditation behind the eyes, not with the eyes, not with the body. Let's imagine we are there behind the eyes. And if we can figure out that we are behind the eyes and stay there, so we don't get pulled by thoughts, pulled by distractions, pulled by attachments, pulled by responsibilities, pulled by things which have tied us completely to a physical reality. Let's relax. Let's relax. Take a vacation. A vacation from physical responsibilities. Vacation from physical thoughts, responsibilities. I have to do this, I have to do that. For a short period, take a relaxation from there and sit behind the eyes, imagining, where am I? What can I do? You can do everything. You can do everything that you can do with physical body and much more. Let's start flying in the sky. Very easy. Completely different from in the physical body. You can't fly. Imaginary body can fly. Wonderful. Fly into sky. Fly, do things. All in the behind the eyes, in the darkness front. Light it up. See how bright. I can take you through meditation exercises like that, starting with your imaginative self, and show you lights which you've never seen outside. They're all there. Power of imagination is so wonderful. You can see anything inside. Imagine you are there. What will happen? You will get so engrossed. Your attention will be so carried by that you will withdraw your experience of what is happening outside. This withdrawal of experience is achieved because of the great gifts we have all been given. The gift of imagination. The gift of awareness. The gift we are aware of things. And we, in awareness, we can create awareness of imagination, awareness of physical awareness, and the power to concentrate our attention on any part of that awareness. Very big thing. Supposing I am now talking to you. From the corner of my eye, I can see these beautiful flowers here. I can touch them also and know them, but I can also see them from the corner of my eye. I can also see you. I can see a cup like this. I must have good peripheral vision. I can also see this side. But it's all a scattered attention if I can see all these things. Now supposing I now turn my head on the flower and look at the flower deeply, each petal, each this thing, and concentrate on this. Now I'm not bothered about you. I've lost awareness of you. This is a great power we have. The power that in our awareness, which is scattered, we can use concentration of attention. What is attention? Attention is the ability to limit the area of your awareness to a small section. When you say read a book with attention, we are not aware what's outside. Our attention gets onto the book and we can read with attention. Looking at the flowers attentively puts my attention in a smaller area. What a beautiful way that using the power of attention on our awareness, we can, in our imaginative awareness, concentrate our attention on what is happening here, nowhere else. It automatically leads to a loss of awareness, a withdrawal of awareness from other things. And that is why meditation becomes effective by simple use of these gifts given to us: awareness, attention, ability to concentrate attention, and the ability to use these three, not only in physical universe, in the imaginary universe also, in the mental universe also. We can use all these. So when you use these three, you are able to withdraw their awareness from other things. we can completely withdraw our attention from the physical universe and the physical body simply by concentrating attention on our imaginative self inside. Good first step. If you can do that, you have scored a big victory towards good meditation. The rest will become easier. If you can do this first leap from being able to shift your reality from what you think is the only physical reality to something that you are used by starting the concentration process, not in the body, but on the imaginative self behind the eyes inside your head. So this first step is so important that my master, great master Baba Sawan Singh would say, do not start meditation till you have practiced this part. Because most of the people who went to him were practicing just closing their eyes and thinking they have physical bodies. He said, it doesn't work. First, make yourself imaginatively present in the head by starting to say, I am inside the head, there's a space and that darkness. Then forget the head. Don't hold on to the limitation of the space. You've just gone in. Imagine you stay there. The whole world opens up there. It's your imaginative world. Meditate there. Start meditation there, not anywhere else. If you start meditation there, it'll be effective. Otherwise, the body, the world, the attachment, the distraction will hold you here forever. Very important point. So I am going to share with you all the steps that you can take till the discovery of the real self, beyond mind, beyond sense perceptions, beyond imagination, beyond physical reality, beyond dream reality, which is possible with the method that great master taught me. I have come to share these experiences with you, and I am sharing them with the express orders and permission of my master. I normally don't share this thing. My experiences, I am not supposed to be sharing with anybody. So only with his express direction. Why? Because I discovered early on the value of service, which we call seva. That seva is a very big thing. I did not know how important seva is to serve. To serve who? Serve anybody, serve yourself, serve God, serve your isht, serve your whoever is your beloved, serve your master, serve anybody, serve the people. Seva is very important because a good seva means that you are willing to do something for somebody without expecting anything back. That's called seva. If you expect something back, that's not seva. That's a business transaction. I'm doing this for you, you give me that. It's a business transaction. If there is expectation of anything, that is not seva. In the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna tells Arjuna about a yoga, which he calls karma yoga, yoga of action. He says, if you want to be a yogi, to get enlightenment, perform your action with the utmost skill, with no expectation of any fruit thereof, no compensation for that. If you expect compensation, it's not yoga. And yoga is not merely action. Yoga karma supaushalam. Yoga with the utmost skill. You are doing something with the utmost skill without expecting a reward. That is seva, that is karma, karma yoga. I understood the importance of that when I found great master explaining that when you are willing to do something without expecting anything back, it's a very big way to control your mind, which is always full of desire to get something back. Now you are defeating one of the main functions of your mind, which is keeping you, holding you back here. All attachments, all desire, they're all working here. You are willing to do something to overcome that. It's a very big thing. And seva does not mean a particular kind of action, any action. When I was very young, I was introduced to Great Master very young. For a long time, I was a rebel against this because I thought I was caught up by a young person. I didn't get the time to think about it. But that's a different story. I saw Great Master sitting there in the Dera in Bias, India, and no electric power there. In hot weather, he's giving discourses. And some sevadar, somebody who's doing seva, standing with a big fan behind him, fanning him, that big fan. And it occurred to me, what a lucky man he is, so close to Master, fanning him like that. I wish I could do it. So I once crept along to the stage, and I jumped on the stage to take the fan from that man. And he said, get down, you're too small for this. And no, you don't jump. He scolded me. Great Master smiled and said, give him the fan. I can never forget that. Give him the fan. Fan was as big as I was. And I took the fan and I fanned Great Master. For a few moments, maybe a few minutes. I can never forget it. I got a chance to do seva. I can never forget for my life. He gave me some other work to do. I did it, and it was great satisfaction to me. I got chance to do seva. Today, you might think I've come to give you talks. No, I'm still doing seva for him. This, my presence here is an opportunity given to me by him for seva to him. Not to you guys, it's for him. But by chance, you may get some benefit too. They're incidental. Seva is so important. So that is why when we get a chance to do seva, Great Master said something very beautiful, which also I liked when I was growing up. He said, seva done without expectation of any reward, you will find at the end helps you in meditation and is as effective in concentrating your attention as meditation. Seva can help you to do things because you're training your mind in a different way. Therefore, your ability to overcome the mind, overcome the distractions of the mind, becomes stronger just by seva. It's a wonderful thing. So what I am doing now is not claiming to be anybody. I'm not a teacher or anybody. I'm just sharing with his command, sharing the experiences so that they can benefit to others. In 1937, Great Master said something to an American disciple. His name was Dr. Julian Johnson. Very good doctor, full of humor. I spent a lot of time with him. I was much younger than him, but we became good friends. Julian Johnson came as a missionary to Calcutta in India to convert people to Christianity. And he believed that belief that you have faith in Jesus Christ, he's a savior, and belief in his power to save you and his spirit is alive. Therefore, he was telling people to become Christian, which was common. Many other missionaries were also working in the same way. So he was sent from the United States. But two friends of his in America, who were disciples of Great Master, and they had become disciples because of another Indian disciple of Master who had gone there and interacted with them. So they became. They said to Julian Johnson, if you get a chance, you must go and see this mystic, this master on the River Bias. So while he was doing his work in Calcutta, he wrote to Great Master that my friends have suggested I come and see you. And I'm living in Calcutta. It's a long distance from where you are. When can I come and see you? So Great Master, through an English-knowing attorney, Bhagat Singh, wrote to him, you can come by train. There's a fast train that comes from Calcutta. It does not stop at the railroad station where Bias is, where the Dera is, where the Master is. it stops short of this, 25 miles short in Jalandhar, or it stops 25 miles later in Amritsar, best is you get off in Jalandhar. And then this attorney of mine, the friend of mine, will bring you to the Dera. Incidentally, the attorney lived very close to the Jalandhar railroad station. So he'll be able to pick you up and bring in his car to the Dera. So Julian Johnson arrived. And while he was arriving to go to the Dera to see Great Master said to Bhagat Singh, whose name was Bhagat Singh, that attorney, let's play a little game. Now, you people may not think that Master do that. They do it very often. Perfect living Master. Not the serious-minded yogis and others. Only PLMs, perfect living Master. They show their human side in a way you may not have seen before. He said, Bhagat Singh, this man coming from America, serious-minded missionary, let's play a little game with him. The game will be, I'll come to Jalandhar and hide in your house. So when he comes and he says he's keen to see me, take me to the Dera, you say, why are you in a hurry? Let me take you to my house and I'll give you a cup of tea, then we'll go. And he'll say, no, this is the conversation Great Master is having with Bhagat Singh. Then he will say, no, I want to go there. I've come to see the Master, not for a cup of tea. You insist on it. He will get irritated, get a little angry. But you still insist. When in that mood he will come to your house, you say, Julian Johnson, I have a surprise for you. And bring him into the living room. I'll be sitting there. I'll receive him. This was planned by the Great Master. The same thing happened. Julian Johnson came, Bhagat Singh received him at the railroad station and said, look, it's a long journey you had in the train. I'll take you to my home, we'll have a cup of tea and relax a little, then we'll go to the Dera. And Julian said, no, I am not come for tea or something. I'd like to go and meet this man who's been recommended by my friends from the United States. He said, what's the hurry? Let's go home. He was irritated, as was predicted. And so Bhagat Singh brings him to the house in that mode. He says, Dr. Julian Johnson, I have a surprise for you. And he brings him in, Great Master sitting on a chair. He says, welcome. And he is really surprised. He sits there looking at the man. He says, Master, you traveled all this way to receive me? And Great Master says, you traveled thousands of miles to see me. I just came 25 miles. So, I am very happy to see you. He sat there speechless. If it wasn't a surprise, he might have had a good conversation. I think this was deliberately done to make him speechless. That's what he reported. He sat there speechless looking at the man. Without speaking, without. But somehow, he felt he had reached the right place because he typed out a letter that night, which, by the way, he shared with me, showed me that letter. He typed out a letter to his friends in the United States. I have just spent a few hours in the presence of the Great Master, and if I get nothing more than that, I'm satisfied with what I got. Such was the impact on him just by meeting the Great Master. Big impact. He got initiated. He did more meditation than most of us ever did there. He built a little cave. When he heard some of the yogis and swamis who come there, they do long meditation and they do in caves on the bluff of that river, Vyas. He also built his own cave, dug a cave. It was a little better designed. He put a little rug and carpet also and made a wooden door on it. And he would meditate for hours and hours in that cave. Once in a while, he let me also meditate in his cave. Became known as Johnson's cave. So he tried to do the meditation in a way, so much meditation he did. And became very fond of the Great Master. And then one day, this is in 1937, I'm telling you, Great Master telling him, I was there. He said, Johnson, you have come to take spirituality to America. This has been, the spiritual masters have been appearing in the East, in the Far East, China, India, Middle East. They will now appear in the West, especially in America, United States. He mentioned from where you have come. He says, the American seekers are ready. More will be coming. All they will need will be to explain the teachings I give here in their words in America. These are his words to Julia Johnson. And he wrote a number of letters. Two or three letters are even now available in the books, where he wrote to American disciples that this spiritual tradition, spiritual availability to people, which has existed for centuries in the East, is going to move to the West. The access of spirituality will shift to the West and localize in a big way in the United States. All the seekers need just to get the teachings explained in that way. It's a remarkable thing. I was working in civil service in India. And even after my retirement from civil service, I was given choice of two big jobs, governorship of a state and membership of the planning commission at a cabinet level position. But I said, great master said, spirituality is moving to the West in America. I should go and take a ringside seat to watch that. I came here simply to see the ring, to get into the show that will shift from East to West, and I'm seeing it now. I'm seeing something happening that great master predicted long ago. So this is why he gave me that seva, why he has asked me to do this. It's his march, his will. But I'm very happy to get the chance to do his seva. I don't think there's anything higher. This seva is no different in terms of seva than my fanning him or carrying a glass of water for him or carrying some flowers for him on his table or delivering a meal to somebody. All seva is equal. And I'm making this point because people come to me, that better seva was taken over by somebody else, it was my seva. We're supposed to reduce our ego with seva, not add to it by saying it's my seva, it's my better seva. Seva is all the same, so long as it is done with love and devotion and no expectation of any return. I'll come back and see you in the afternoon. But remember, the beginning is inside, not with the physical body. Start with your inner imaginative self. That is where the true meditation will start. In the afternoon, if you like, we can do a little practice also. So that what I'm talking is not a theoretical model of something. It's something anybody can practice. We human beings have been endowed with this capacity to realize ourselves. And that's a good step. So when I see you in the afternoon, it will be about 3 o'clock, I'll get some practice. Think over what I've said. Prepare yourself for good meditation. And if you want to really go into deeper meditation later on, you wait for any announcements of IMRs. And if you get the chance, IMR, because the number was limited, the number of people who want to go to each IMR is large. So it is designed to announce the number of IMR at the same time. Say 4 IMRs in 2 years. So you could pick up one. So supposing we get 80 people in one, in 4 of them, we'll get 240 people. My multiplication is bad. We'll get 4 times. So we will, but you can go to one of them. That way we get a chance to more people. But even then the demand was more than that number of people. So the organization that arranges this meeting, ISHA, Institute for Study of Human Awareness, they designed a system of doing the registration on the computer that at a certain time it'll open and you press the right button to register, you get it. So many people press at the right button, so many instantly got the message, waiting list. It's very surprising that most of the IMR filled up in a few seconds. I'm trying to see how we can make it a better arrangement, maybe more IMRs in more places, and also make it available at least certain percentage of that available only to people living in that area, because I was surprised that an IMR was held somewhere in Asia or in Europe, and there were more Americans there than there were in Europe. So I said, how did that happen? They said, the American computers are better. Response time is more or less. So to overcome that, we are thinking of doing something better. But I am very keen that we, instead of merely talking about it, discussing about it, practice it, get the benefit, test it out. These are not things just for discussion. This is something to practice and see the results. And if there are problems coming in the practice, get relief, get answers, get solutions, move forward. Don't get stuck and stay there. I'm saying these words because people are coming to me meditating for 30, 40, 50 years with no progress. They're stuck at the beginning, stuck somewhere right in the early stages, and never got a chance to get the clarification how to move forward, what happened. I want to help you as best as I can to move forward, not get stuck anywhere. So that is why it's a matter of practice, regular practice. So enjoy the lunch now. I'll see you 3 o'clock again, and we do a little practice starting here only. Thank you very much.